We are the professionals. What are the other areas or the avenues of our professional practice that has been untapped or very thinly has been addressed? So I would really request all the members, participants and audience to make it as interactive as possible, because it's really a very dynamic subject, too vast, too diversified. It may look like that 2 hour session is a long session, but believe me, the more we interact, you know, the 2 hour sessions will just go like 20 minutes. This is my experience. So that said, we have got a chat box. I know, you know, like the difficulty and as well as the beauty of having a virtual meeting. Now, because the difficulty is that we are at a different place. We don't have a person-to-person interactions, you know, at least on face-to-face. But yes, we have face that we can see. So I would really request all the members, participants here to use the chat box. Certainly, I would love to answer as many questions as practicable, and to make it a moving discussions, I would also ask some questions so that we all are engaged during these 2 hour sessions. So my first questions to all the members, because we are all practicing member of the institute, I have few very commonsensical questions. I'm sure all of us know, but to set the agenda more appropriate, more context and more arrow pointed, I really have few questions, and I really need the answer in the chat box. Then of course I'll share the slides and we'll have the whole sessions. So I've got 5 questions. I'll be very happy to see members write their answers in the chat box. So the first question I have is, who gave us the Chartered Accountant Act? If my members can answer me, just four or five questions, answer please. That was framed in way back in 1949. Finally, the accounting professions or the accounting professionals, we got the Chartered Accountant Act, not the Registered Accountant.
Yes.
Then the second question I have, sir, is how old is the accounting profession? I'm just typing. Accounting profession, how old it is? What is this symbolic tagline of ICAI? The fourth question I have, what is the objective tagline? Members may feel a bit awkward that why I'm asking these questions, but really I'm setting the agenda for the whole discussions. I just want the common feelings. Who understands what? Who has what impressions? Very nice. Mr. Kali Charan, our beloved member, Chitra Gupta is the eldest accountant. I really like it. Thanks for your wisdom, sir. Let's find out these answers. Even I don't know what are the answers. But certainly for sure, the moment we go through some of our key presentations, I may assure you with a lot of confidence and wisdom in my command that yes, we have a lot of things to do. Perhaps we still have not achieved the minimum potential of our professions, that is rest assured. Now let's discuss, sir. Sir, so how old is the accounting profession then, before and now? One of our members, CA Kali Charan, really, I congratulate you that you really carry a lot of wisdom in the professional thing, that you know the accounting profession goes back even to the mythological era. Chitragupta is the eldest accountant, very rightly said. So we are safe to assume that accounting profession goes back to the mythological era. Now the question comes, sir, how it has evolved, the accounting professions. If you see, the accounting professional used to be considered as the most wisest person even during the kingdom era. So if you compare, eagle is the symbol of ICAI, that means our eyes should be like eagle. Okay, partly true, you are CA Pawan Agrawal. Thanks for the answer. Okay, we'll come to, you know, like the answer part of that questions. So let's understand. So, you know, like the chartered accountant, had we been in the era of the kingdom culture, then where would have been our role, you know, any the palace of any magistrate? You know, we can safely say that we used to be the advisor or the Rajguru to the highness of kings. And even if you go back to the pre-independence era, it's not like that the accounting professions has emerged post-independence. No, sir. Even pre-independence, we had the position of controller and auditor general of India, even during the British era. So what were the objects? They were kind of the vigilance officers, you know, in terms of measuring the affairs, efficacy, and well-being of all public spending, even during the British era. Of course, came the 1949, we had our institute established, the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Let's check the facts, fictions, and truth of ICAI. Our members may hold an impression, perhaps the ICAI as a body of accounting regulator came into being post-independence, that is after 1947. That is wrong, sir. If we go historically, then the government of India in 1930 decided to maintain the Register of Accountant. The Register of Accountant was nothing but to create a register for who are going to be the auditor to remain accountable for government spendings. Then the government at that point of time created this Indian Accounting Board, called upon to prescribe the qualification for auditors, called the Registered Accountant that time. Then many accountants at that time were also members of the prestigious Institute of Chartered Accountants of England and Wales, and other chartered societies of Great Britain, the institution established under the Royal Charter. I'm just trying to answer that who gave us the Chartered Accountant Act. Sir, that time majority were hesitant to be called as certified public accountant, because the Indian Accounting Board came up with a suggestions that we should create a body to be called as certified public accountant. But that was preferred by the majority. They choose to be called as chartered accountant as against this certified public accountant, because they were considering that the members of Institute of Chartered Accountants of England and Wales, perhaps they carry more brand value than the certified public accountant of India. So that is how the majority support were in favor of chartered accountant as against certified public accountant. So that is how the Institute of Chartered Accountants came into being. And rightly, CA Pawan Agrawal said, our logo is Garuda. And, you know, I asked in one question, what is the symbolic tagline? Of course, the symbolic tagline was, Ya Ayesu Supteshu Jagruti, which means we awake even when we sleep. So that is the depth of our professions, that even hum jab sote rehte tabhi bhi hum jagte hain, that means we perform even while we are sleeping. ICAI was established in 1st July 1949, that is something we all know, and we have a glorious 71 plus years. And what is our national importance? When I say that what is the symbolic tagline, our symbolic tagline is Ya Ayesu Supteshu Jagruti, that is the tagline attached to our logo. The logo plus Garuda placed at the center of the symbol. Then what is the national importance? What is the objective tagline? The objective tagline was given by His Excellency, late our President, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, that we are partners in nation building. So that is the line of tagline with objectivity. Then our current member strength is 3,10,000 plus. We have got a vast member presence in major demographic area, both in domestic and international circuit. Sir, I can safely ask some of our fellow professionals, they may not be known in the practitioner practicing area, but who really has made a mark in terms of this calling of the national duty as chartered accountant, being the partner of a nation building. I have few names to share. Padma Shri Sri T.N. Manoharan, we know that he is neither known for his tax representations or as an auditor, but yes, he has been a vibrant writer and lecturer. Then Padma Shri Sri T.V. Mohandas Pai. We know he has been the chairman of Manipal Global Education. We have Sri Anil R. Dave, former judge of Supreme Court of India. We also have C.A. Swaminathan Gurumurthy, co-convener of Swadeshi Jagran Manch. And you would be surprised to know he runs a weekly Tamil weekly called as the Garuda and a Chartered Accountant. Hari Salve, we know Padma Bhushan Hari Salve, he has been the former Solicitor General of India and the Council of India to have represented the famous Kulbhushan Jadhav case in International Court of Justice. We also have Rameshwar Thakur, His Excellency, former Union Minister of India and Governor of various states, including Andhra and Odisha. We have Narendra Kumar Salve, former Union Minister and President Board of BCCI. We also have CSE Suresh Kumar Prabhu. We all know him. We have Arun Puri, founder and editor chief of India Today. We also have N.J. Yashwami, founder of ICFI Business. So we know that they are our members, but known for their creative pursuit in different fields, apart from the profession of accounting and the traditional practice of accounting and tax. So let's understand the accounting depth of a chartered accountant. You know, so what is the academics, research and the grilling to go to become a CA? We all know the quantum of study, the quantum of subjects we study, be it at the intermediate stage or be it at the final stage. Accounting, cost accounting and financial management, taxation, audit and assurance, business law, information technology, strategic financial management, corporate and other laws, quantitative aptitude, general economics and business communications. Members, I would like to ask you that if I have to say, we have in depth studied so much of the subject, how much in percentage, say in a scale of 1 to 100, we are using in our day-to-day practice? Any answer, please, on the chat box? Individual member may please share their experience. How much they're using in their day-to-day practice? From a scale of 1 to 100%, how much we're using? Answer, please. No. No answer. Okay. So let's move next. You know, like currently we are having, so majority of our members may agree that the traditionally, you know, our practice domain surrounds around accounting and bookkeeping, statutory audit. We call the audit under the Companies Act, namely, there are, of course, there are other statutes under which we do the audit work. And there are tax compliance and tax audits, bank audits, GST compliance and audit, tax representations, tax litigations, loans and project financing, insolvency and bankruptcy, forensic audit, then of course there is the valuation exercise. I believe our members will agree if I put the top 7, they come under the general practice, and the bottom 4 perhaps comes as a very specific skill set, or we may call the expert advice or the expert practice. So if I can ask the members, how many of our members, can you please confirm in the chat box, are into forensic audit? Any member present here who is into forensic audit? Any member who is into forensic audit, or anybody into insolvency and bankruptcy? Anybody who is an IRP?
Myself is acting as an insolvency professional this side, RP Bhardwaj sir.
Very nice sir, very nice. So we have 61 participants.
Insolvency and liquidation.
Okay, very nice. Very nice to know, sir. So anybody else who is into IRP practice?
Transaction audit and try this forensic audit done through others, but we are not doing it ourselves.
Okay, okay. So anybody into loans and project financing? No. Anyone who is a valuation professionals holds the registered valuer degree? Anybody?
काफी लोग हैं हमारे स्टडी सर्कल में. हमारे स्टडी सर्कल
में अग्रवाल, आई नो हिम, इज अ रेजिडेंट
वैल्यू. अबाउट 25 पीपल वर्किंग एज इनसॉल्वेंसी प्रोफेशनल्स, बट दे मस्ट नॉट बी प्रेजेंट इन दिस मीटिंग.
ओके, सो आई मेक करेक्ट टू अज्यूम सर दैट यू नो लाइक इन आवर मेंबर सर्कल एटलीस्ट इफ नॉट मोस्ट बट एटलीस्ट सब्सटेंशियल पीपल आर इनटू द प्रैक्टिस ऑफ ऑल दिस एग्जिस्टिंग 7 11 टाइप्स ऑफ प्रैक्टिस. Mr. Bharadwaj, am I right to assume that at least 11 sorts of practice our members know?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So let's move to the next slide. Okay, let's put it like perhaps these are the traditional practice. We are the members of our ICAI who has practicing chartered accountants. Depending on our client circles, we small way or big way are already into these sorts of practice, starting from accounting and bookkeeping to the high-end valuation consulting. Now let's move into the what are the other practice area that is available to us. Before that, I would really love to hear the concern of our members. I see when I interact with our fellow members, there are certain changes that has occurred in recent past, and few are also going to change or are going to affect our day-to-day practice. Members are free to really enlighten me if there are any other areas. To the extent I know, you know, few of the changes that has happened in our economic surroundings that has affected the practice of our members. Say for an example, the audit under section 44AB, as we call the tax audit, enhancing the turnover limit or the gross receipts limit to 5 crores. Then the second thing, GST audit, lot of hype was created, that this will give us good work. Members will find some bright opportunity, but only to be seen that yes, GST audit and submission of reconciliation statement is scrapped. The requirement has been scrapped. I'm sure few of the members must have been affected. With the charging of several banks, the quantum of audits and bank audits, be it on the revenue audits, be it on the statutory branch level or at the concurrent audit level, they have also gone down drastically. Then the definition of account has now been upheld for other contemporary institutes that yes, the definition of accountants would also include the members of other parallel institutes. If that happens, then of course we know where do we stand in terms of our ability and our entitlement to represent before various regulatory bodies. Then the ease of doing business certainly has scrapped and is going to scrap multiple level of compliances, and it has also given relaxation to small companies in terms of following certain accounting standards, specific reporting of auditors. Then the valuations to be done, which earlier either a merchant banker or a chartered accountant, but now under the Income Tax Act for certain purposes, the valuation has to be done by only a merchant banker. So we as members know then those who were into valuations, how much a business volume or a professional practice we are going to lose to our counterpart, the merchant banker. So members may please share if they see that there are any other changes that has affected their routine practices. May please write flag off in the chat box. Yes, please. Or anybody who wants to answer or speak to me. Mr. Bharadwaj, if you could facilitate. I'm not sure if members are finding any difficulty.
Sir, kindly interact with the speaker if you have any kind of query or questions or clarification is required. Kindly interact with the speaker. He likes to be more interactive in this session. Please.
Yes. Let's make it vibrant. Members, we should speak more. Engage more. That will help. The other few slides are certainly going to be very interesting, very interesting. But before that, we really have to have a mindset.
एक्चुअली क्या है, हम लोग जो ये वर्चुअल मोड में आ गए ना, जब जब ये फिजिकल होती है और आप लोग बीच बीच में घूम के एक आदमी को फेस टू फेस आंखें मिला के जब पूछते हो, जब ज्यादा मजा आता है इंटरेक्शन में. अदरवाइज ये वर्चुअल में इंटरेक्शन नहीं हो पाता ज्यादा. सॉरी फॉर दिस कमेंट.
नो प्रॉब्लम सर, नो प्रॉब्लम. वी हैव गॉट अ चैट बॉक्स. लेट्स गिव 2 मिनट्स टू ईच आवर मेंबर. वी आर ऑल मेंबर ऑफ अ नोबल प्रोफेशंस. आवर नोबिलिटी एनहांसेस. More we discuss, more we deliberate.
जब हम आमने सामने बैठ के आंखों में आंखें मिला के और जब बात करते हैं तो वो इंटरेक्शन अलग टाइप का होता है, वो वर्चुअल मोड में नहीं आ सकता.
I know sir, I know, I know. Anyway, so I'm moving to the next slide, right? So members, I really am going to be a partner in all your both good days and bad days. So that's why if they, our fellow members are going to lose business, then I also see that I am also losing, right? So there is nothing that we as individuals or we are all as a practicing units are going to gain, you know, because of all these implementations that has happened. So now where do we stand or where are we supposed to go? So the new territory where our members can really set their practice. I call it the new territory, the value enhancement program. When I say value enhancement program, the value enhancement program consulting. This is an area where every company, you know, more so the multinational company, are really looking forward to see a not just getting into the core activities of audit or compliances or filing. They are interested to see whether we are in a position to give them consulting, so that that will transfer into some value added activities of the products or the services they are doing. So what we can do or what we should do, what should be the expected outcome from our wisdoms or our area of expertise. We must study the client profile. We must study the client or the promoter's background. We must be able to do their core competency analysis, study of client industry, the demand supply analytics. Then we must do the doing gap analysis where our client is not doing good, but if he or she can course correct something, then where they can really make a successful venture out of it. Then our suggestions, expected suggestions are automations. We have to advise our clients where they should do automations and should focus on key core values. That is called as their core concentrations. Then we should also do some analysis that where the client should get into some affiliations or complementing arrangement with other peer industrial businessmen, business houses, and where they should get some registration others. Then MSME. So this is going to be, of course, I know for sure few of our members have already diversified their practice in terms of MSME consultings with the, you know, like the stock exchange is also now ready to list some of the MSME, you know, under a different outfits. So the MSME certainly is going to be the thrust and fortune of our Indian economy. So what are the benefits available to MSME? Our members should really tap the potentials. The benefits and the privilege on store, collateral free loans to banks, subsidy on patent registrations. All MSME registered company can really get their patent registered at half of the fees. Then there are industrial promotion subsidy and protection against payments or delayed payments. We all know even there is a recent amendment that has come up that if the payments to MSME vendors are not paid, then those expenses will permanently be disallowed. Then ISO certification charges reimbursements, special consideration on international trade fairs. The Ministry of Commerce is promoting in a very big way now that MSME sectors can really avail these benefits. Waiver of stamp duty and registration fees, access to tenders. The Government of India under the Atmanirbhar Bharat scheme, which of course we will be discussing the latter part of our discussions in some other slides, that few of these supplies made to, you know, the public sectors under the public procurement policies are going to be reserved, are already reserved, and there is a major chunk now going to be reserved for the small and medium enterprises. Then reservation policies to manufacturing and production sector. Similarly, there will also be certain priority sectors where manufacturing setup had to be done by only MSME enterprises. Then we know there is a new scheme the Government of India has launched, you know, to ensure a central procurement hub for all the public procurement that all PSU companies are doing. This is an online platform for public procurement in India, launched on August 9, 2016 by Ministry of Commerce. It's an open and transparent procurement platform for government procurement. So now, where is the scope for we chartered accountants? I really encourage our members, they should very sincerely look it as a very specific practice. Lot of practicing opportunities are available in terms of getting our clients registered under the e-marketplace, the GEM portal. We can also represent the ministry in terms of various issues. There are also teething problems, grievances handling, and vigilance support that is also required from our members if we want to serve our clients or potential clients. This is certainly going to be a new area of practice. Few of the members that is known in me have specialized in this area now. Then we have the Make in India, Atmanirbhar Bharat. We all know that this is certainly going to be a game changer in placing India, you know, like in the forefront of global market. So the objective is to nation to becoming self-reliant. to reduce external dependability in terms of procurement. Then focus is to shift to make in India, then easy and cheap import. It's not like that import would be completely banned, not like that. But certainly it's certainly going to impact the, you know, like imports. And allocation, there are 20 lakh crores of economic package that has been declared to promote Atmanirbhar Bharat. Then what is the scope for we practitioners? We certainly can emerge as investment advisory on competing products to import. We know which are the imports that certainly going to be affected. Then of course, this will also augment the indigenous manufacturing. So that is where our members really need to come good, you know, in terms of advising our clients that which are the area they should get into the manufacturing, because there is going to be a huge, huge, huge demand for indigenous products. Then FDA on manufacturing of focus products, technological collaboration where Indian player doesn't have the technical capacities. We all know, because even if the nation is going to be self-reliant, but there are certain products where you don't have the technical apparatus. So there we need to collaborate with our overseas counterpart, although the manufacturing will take place in India, in some factory or some manufacturing unit of India. But of course, the technology has to be provided by the overseas entrepreneur. So that is exactly where our member have got a lot of consulting opportunity. Then of course, then there is this startup and crowdfunding requirement. Then since there is a huge bunch of demand, then that's exactly where we members can certainly come good in terms of advising or in terms of incubating certain startup and crowdfunding opportunity. So members have any questions on there till these slides? Mr. Bharadwaj? Not really?
I request our participants to kindly put questions in between if you have any doubt.
Any doubt, please, questions.
Actually, there is, sir, there is some network problem at my end, and I have logged in from two devices. The meeting was started from my laptop, and I am speaking from this my mobile phone.
No problem, sir. No problem. Okay.
It created.
I'm moving to the
network problem. I think this internet connectivity at my desk is a problem today.
Okay, fine. So I'm moving to the next slide.
Please.
Then, as we all know, there is a growing requirement, also a growing realization that yes, the corporate governance in India needs to be addressed and needs to be upgraded. So that is where exactly we as the chartered accountants have got a big, big, big opportunity now. We certainly can act as independent director. There is already a dearth of independent director in almost every corporate, big and small, big and medium sized, right? And that is exactly where our members can really try their hands. We can be independent director in the several companies, and we can really make our value added services count in terms of strengthening corporate governance. So what is the role of independent directors? The role with objectivity is to play a significant role at the board level, right? As a whistleblower for corporate governance. Who is our regulator? We of course will be regulated under the aegis of the Minister of Corporate Affairs. Members may know, but at the cost of reputations, I must say, the nodal agency is Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs, IICA. They are maintaining a data bank now for independent directors, or there is also an exam conducted by the Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs. Our members should take the benefit of it. They certainly should be there in the list of the data bank, because sooner or later, there is going to be a lot of appointment and engagement flowing from this database. Then what is the scorecard? What are the key attributes? Then of course, for us to be a successful independent directors, our key attribute is knowledge over specific business, governance, and ethics. Scorecard certainly going to be ethical actions, escalations, and whistleblower. That is what is going to be the expected outcome of independent directors in every corporate board. So what is our scope as an independent advisor? Then we are going to be agents of change for corporate governance. Then we have got a key role in terms of advisory, advising the various committees of the board and the board also in general. And we are supposed to act like whistleblower. If anything goes wrong, our role is supposed to be more preventive than reactive. Then I'm sure our members must be aware. It's going 1 second. Okay, so consultant under the labor code, as we all know, you know, there has been a major reforms directed towards the ease of doing business. So there are 29 central level laws now consolidated into 4 labor codes. This is an area where all our members should really think whether they would be keen. There is of course a huge requirement. There is of course going to be huge professional opportunity. Our members, if they are keen, they really should try to test their hands in these fields. You know, there are 29 central labor laws that have been consolidated into 4 labor codes. So the transition from labor law to labor codes is certainly going to bring us a lot of representations and litigation opportunity in the area. So if you talk very specifically, we have got the code on wages. Right, it legislates on wages and bonus aspects relating thereto, and it has really subsumed 4 existing central labor laws, namely the Remuneration Act of 1976, the Minimum Wages Act of 1948, the Payment of Wages Act 1936, and the Payment of Bonus Act 1965. They all are capped under the Code on Wages. Similarly, there is this the Code on Social Security Act of 2020. These are subsumed 9 labor laws, extant labor laws previously, namely the Employees Compensation Act 1923, the State Insurance Act 1948, the Provident Funds and Miscellaneous Provision Acts of 1952, the Employment Exchanges Act of 1959, and some others. So we see the 9 labor laws have been subsumed under the single code to be called as the Code on Social Security Act of 2020. Then there are 2 other labor code also.
This Many conference will now be recorded.
Going to come. So this is a gold mine of opportunity for our new members or even existing members. Then, as you know, there is this recent good news that has come to all members as a bonus post pandemic, that the apex body of university, the University Grant Commissions, have recognized CA degree as equivalent to master degree. This has been notified now. So we are akin to MCOM. So that being the case, any CA having a passion for research can certainly pursue the PhD, the Doctorate of Philosophy. After being CA, we don't need to spend another 2 years in to pursue become MCOM. Then we can also join the teaching professions after clearing the UGC NET exam. anybody who is interested to join as any university as a lecturer can do so, provided they crack the UGC NET exam. We can now appear in UGC NET based on our CA degree. There are also freelancing research and a lot of, you know, as a lucrative lectureships on freelancing basis with a lot of edu technology coming into picture. There are a lot of various programs, skills enhancement programs, academic programs, training programs, right? So Arbor certainly can join, you know, like as a freelancing lectures, providing freelancing lectures. So this is a good career making opportunity for our members. Then there is this huge consultancy opportunity. Anybody who understands the import and export business, who have got clients or client base, our most of our clients are also into exports. So under the export, if our clients are having exports, this is a consultancy opportunity for our members that we can set up our practice only in terms of providing, you know, export consultancy or threat of this, you know, like trade benefits, fiscal trade benefits. So who are entitled to export benefits? Essentially export units, export undertaking under the foreign trade policies. So there are various schemes under the foreign trade policies. The current foreign trade policies, foreign trade policy of 2015 and 2020. So under the FTP policy of 15 and 20, which has been extended due to pandemic by another 1 year. So this is the exceptional foreign trade policy period. That is 6 years as against 5 years previously. So the FTP of 2015 to 20 enhanced by another 1 year. So there is this policy called as benefits, which is under chapter 5, that is called as export promotion capital goods. So any export units which is likely to import capital goods or to project import, you know, like in terms of setting up any plants, we certainly as professionals can really provide them the professional help, because under the foreign trade policy of EPCG, there is this duty exemptions available. So how? All imports except specified in appendix 5F. So 5F is essentially the negative list, the prohibited goods can be procured without payment of duty. Capital goods permitted for pre-productions, production and post-productions without payment of customs duty. Capital goods imported under EPCG authorizations for physical export are also exempt from IGST. So not just the custom duty, but also the IGST under GST is also exempt. Then the obligations, of course, any clients who is going to import under the duty-free basis under APCG authorizations is supposed to fulfill the obligations, the following obligations. Obligation one, export obligation has to be 6 times of duties, taxes, and sales saved in 6 years. So there is a period of 6 years where 6 times of the duty that has been forgone, we have to do the export. Then export obligation shall be 25%. It's not that sacrosanct. So in case we have got a domestic procurement in indigenous sourcing, then the export obligation shall be 25% less. Both subject to user conditions. The user condition means we must affix a charter engineer certifications that yes, the concerned plant or machinery has been used for the purpose of manufacturing of the export items. Then balance can be condoned in case of 75% obligation achieved in less than half of the year period. So if any exporter who is achieving 75% of the obligation amount in half of the period, that is 3 years or less, then 25% is also subject to remissions. Then there is this benefits under chapter 4, like chapter 5 benefit of EPCG. There is also the benefit of duty-free import authorizations. We call it the DFIS scheme. This is to allow duty-free import of input, which is physically incorporated into an output, which is a subject matter of export. Then additions, fuel, oil, catalyst, which is consumed or utilization in production process of export product may also be allowed. DFIS is allowed to manufacturer, exporter or merchant exporter tied to manufacturer. Then what are the obligations? Minimum value addition has to be 20%. So the cost
break of FOB value of export and CIF value of imports, the difference has to be minimum 20%. Export to be completed in 12 months from the date of imports. Then DFIA not available for gems and jewelry sector can opt for advance authorizations. So units in gem and jewelry, they can certainly go for advance authorization as against the DFIA. Balance condone in case of 75% application achieved in less than half of the year period. Then we know there are also still some of the sunset benefits are available to SEGEN units. You know, we as practicing members certainly can have a specializations as set up advisory on SEGEN or even on under UOU. So what are the benefits available to SEGEN units? SEGEN units are free to import from the domestic sources without payment of duty, cess or taxes. That is towards goods, raw material, consumables, spares, packaging materials. Sales to DTI is subject to all normal imports that will be decided as if it is a deemed import if we are making any sales to DTI. SEGEN units are free from the periodic examination by customs while export and import cargo. Then SEGEN units may subcontract a part of their production through units in SEGEN, UOU or EPZ with the permission, of course, with the permission of the customs authorities. Then there is benefits under section 10AA. There is a whole 100% exemptions available for first 5 years. Then there is again a 50% exemptions available for next 5 years. So there is a 10 years horizon where the duty benefits, tax benefits can be availed under section 10AA. 100% of foreign direct investment is freely allowed in manufacturing sector and SEGEN units under the automatic route, except on prohibited sector like arms and ammunitions. There it is not permitted. Baki rest, 100% FDI is permitted under the automatic route. We don't need any approval from RBI. No cap of foreign investment for SSI in reserved items if they are going to set up their units in SEGEN units. Then there are also benefits. The benefits doesn't end here. There are also other benefits available under the zero duty benefits schemes to SEGEN units. Offshore banking units with 100% income tax exemption is available for 5 years. External commercial borrowings by units up to $500 million a year allowed without any maturity conditions. Then freedom to bring in export proceeds without any time limit. Flexibility to keep 100% export proceeds in EEFC account, export under foreign currency accounts. Exemption from interest rate surcharge and import finance, that is also a benefit available to SEGEN units. SEGEN units allowed to write off unrealized export bills, which we all members must have seen. If you don't receive the bills during the prescribed period of 9 months, 15 months or 18 months, then there are permission requirement from RBI. But thankfully, SEGEN units don't have to comply with those conditions. The exemption from goods and service tax to SEGEN units because they operate under the zero-rated benefit schemes. Exemption from capital gains on transfer of an industrial unit from urban area to SEGEN units. So if one transferor is transferring his units to an SEGEN unit from any urban non-SEGEN units, then there are exemptions of capital gains also. All export from DTA units to the zone shall be exempt from state and local body taxes or levies. Then invest income in the form of dividends, interest or long-term capital gains of an infrastructure capital company from investment made in an enterprise engaged in the development, operations or maintenance of SEGEN are exempt under Section 10 of the Income Tax Act. So this is a big benefit for SEGEN developer. Then SEGENs are permitted to have non-polluting industries in IT and facilities. They can set up plants, hotels and non-polluting service industry in the coastal region also. SEGEN units are exempted from public hearing under the environment portlights. Exemptions from requirement of domicile in India for 12 months for appointment as directors. So this is a benefits under the Companies Act, exceptions drawn to promote SEGENs. exemption from part restrictions under drugs and cosmetic rules as far as they are relatable to investigations and others. Subcontracting and contract farming is permitted to SEZ units. Then SEZ units may subcontract part of their productions or production process through units in the domestic tariff area or through other UAUs or SEZ units. This is a big, big incentive for SEZ units. They can certainly subcontract. SEZ units may also subcontract part of their production process abroad. Even they can send to overseas destinations. ECBs by units up to $500 million a year allowed without any mutual restrictions. So external commercial borrowings up to $500 million is also allowed without any maturity restrictions. So any questions till this point? Members? No questions?
Please carry on, sir.
Hello. Okay.
Please carry on.
Okay. So now let's move to the federal schemes, recent schemes. So the government of India has a certain specific sector and very purposeful and very specific attentions. Like the India BPO promotion schemes, we call it the IBPS. So this is envisaged under the Digital India program, launched with objectivity to capacity building in smaller cities, especially as manpower, and would become basis for next wave in IT and ITS. The whole idea has been to take the IT and ITS units to this small to smallest cluster of towns and villages. Then the financial support, 50%. 1 minute. Yes. So up to 50% of expenditure incurred on BPO or ITS towards capital expenditure and operational expenditure on admissible items, subject to an upper ceiling of rupees 1 lakh per seat. So any of our clients who has got, their BPO units in, say, for example, in Delhi, Gurgaon, or any A-town city, if they want to, from metro city, they want to transition to A-town, B-town, or C-town. So there is a very beautiful schemes that is promoted by the Ministry of Electronics and Technology, MeitY, right? So our clients, we can advise our clients to set up their further expansion in B town or C town cities, so they can really get a huge benefits, 50% of their expenditures, or subject to cap of 1 lakh per seat. That is the incentive, that is the size of incentive the government of India is providing. Then there are also special intensive incentives for employment of women and specially enabled persons. Then there is special incentives available given by the ministry. Incentive for generating employment beyond the target and a wider dispersal within state, including rural areas. Encouragement for local entrepreneurs. Special consideration is also provided by the ministry for hilly states of HP, Himachal Pradesh, Jammu and Kashmir, and Uttarakhand. So, members, we can certainly enlarge our scope of practice. As I often put it, this is the handholding advisory. So where we can have a handholding advisory, as we have witnessed, the globally, this has really, the pandemic has put a brake on economic progression in all across the globe, and India is no exceptions. We have seen to what extent our client have struggled. There are capital crunches, there are also survival issues, there are teething problems, there are labor attritions. So issues from all sides, from all aspects, that is, our clients are struggling. So that is exactly where we chartered accountants can really come good you know, in terms of reviving our clients. So insolvency and revival opportunity, of course, we have got a IBC law in place. We have the NCLT, right? And that is exactly where a lot of our professionals are already engaged as IRP. So IRP, when I say IRP, IRP, you know, like, but unfortunately, most of these units going under insolvency process, they are actually ending up as being liquidated. That is an unfortunate and very sorry state of affairs. But that is exactly where we professionals should join hands with our existing insolvency professionals. Rather than liquidating a company, we should give, breath and butter, bread and butter to, you know, like all these struggling units so that they grow, right? So that they revive. So we can really have a lot of handshaking, you know, handholding advisory on this area. So as a matter of this, we should target investment for investors. Then, you know, like we can find that sick units or struggling units or units facing an insolvency process can certainly be a target for, you know, any prospective investors. All that we need to do is a handshake. So there are units, there are also investors. We should be in a position to make the handshake really work. Then there are also closure consolidations, targets and takeover aspects. You know, like our practice really can target in those fronts. Then we have consultations and target finder is a big work, right? If you can really find anybody who is willing to invest in India, looking for an entry advisory or India entry strategy, and we really find him a target company where he has to take over or where he has to invest, then it's certainly going to give us a very big professional opportunity. Then valuations and value creation is one thing which is totally relatable to the subject clients, and we should really tap this potential. Then this is a very specific practice. Our members would be delighted to know that handholding advisory to industry body. It's not the industry as clients, but the industry body also can turn out to be our clients under a lot of this international trade and international trade regulations. So that is one is trade representations on anti-dumping. So what is anti-dumping? The use of anti-dumping measure as an instrument of instrument to kind of prevent imports or mass imports is permitted by WTO, the World Trade Organization. The whole aim is to prevent cheap, low cost and flood of imports to any destinations. Then measure to prevent disruption to domestic manufacturing industry. So this is a provisions that was existing even under the old Excise Act. Then of course, this anti-dumping practice certainly is going to help the Make in India and the Atmanirbhar Bharat scheme to complement with objectivity. Then where exactly is our practitioners, our members can have a practice, can set up a practice here? Yeah. We certainly can make a representation to the apex body. The apex body is none other than the Ministry of Commerce. We all know there is a place called as Udyog Bhavan, right? We can make representation representing the industry, you know, here. It's a huge area of a professional opportunity that already is there and is going to come. With thanks to the federal policy, we have the Atmanirbhar Bharat. So a lot of anti-dumping measures is going to be taken by the government. So that is exactly where we as professional members of ICI should put our footprint forward. What is the approach? The application is deemed to have been made by or on behalf of the domestic industry if it is supported by those domestic producers whose collective output constitute more than 50% of the total production of the like article produced by that portion of the domestic industry, expressing either support for or oppositions as the case may be to the applications. So before we make any application seeking for anti-dumping measures, you know, on behalf of our clients, we must ensure that application is compliant to this very crucial aspects of an anti-dumping applications. So anti-dumping, you know, representations on anti-dumping matter is a very big practice our members should try. Then I think our members are already aware. Maybe even at the legislation level, they all know that came the 2016, November 2016, we had this big law that got the accent of the President of India. That is the Benami Transactions Prohibition Act of 2016. Our members would be very surprised to know. So even if it is called as the Benami Transactions Prohibition Act of 2016, you know, the actual enactment happened by way of an amendment to the old Act of 1988, right? So it came as an amendment in 2016, intending to widen the scope of 1988. It simply means our members can imagine to what extent it can really crop up the litigations, the flood of litigations, because it's actually a retrospective amendment. That means all Benami transactions, even if the enactment came in 2016, but anything that the wrong that has occurred even prior to 2016, it's not free from litigations. So there is a huge amount of litigations that already would have been in place. But unfortunately, it's a measure, you know, like from the top that, yes, the industry is already going through a bad patch. So perhaps the ministry or the concerned department is not trying to further disturb the industry or the investment sentiment. So they are not certainly touching now any errant taxpayers or tax evaders here. Yes. But yes, in time to come, there is going to be huge amount of litigations roaming around the Benami Transactions Prohibition Act of 2016. We should really be prepared to tap this potential. So what is the Benami Transactions? Benami Transactions means any transactions of property which is done in the name of one person and the consideration is paid by another person. So it's such a generic definitions, you know, like we can understand to what extent there would be discretionary judgment, there would be discretionary assessment, you know, like roaming around years of litigations. So, and how grievous is the provisions, you can really see from the last paragraph of this slide. Punishment, apart from confiscations, if somebody is facing a Benami proceedings, the first and foremost thing that is going to be done is to confiscate the property. Property is gone. And more than that, the tragedy doesn't end there. Under Section 53(2), whoever is found guilty of the offence of Benami transaction shall be punishable with rigorous imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 1 year, but which may extend to 7 years, and shall also be liable to fine which may extend to 25% of the fair market value of the property. Property is gone, imprisonment comes as a bonus, and putting a penalty is an additional baggage. So this is how grievous, how draconian the provisions under the Benami Act is. So our members really need to be prepared in terms of creating logistics, in terms of enhancing their wisdoms, you know, to prepare for defending their clients or the prospective clients in future. So this is going to be a huge area of practice, you know, like giving a lot of opportunity to our members. Then audit beyond the financial horizons. When we say audit, normally, you know, like what Suomoto comes to our mind is, you know, the statutory audit, the tax audit, the internal audits, but there are also other areas of audits that really going to open up a huge area of opportunity for us. That is the sustainable audit, right? Then there are going to be CSR audit. We know came 2013. Section 135 of 2013 Companies Act mandates compulsory spending of 2% by, you know, the corporates, eligible corporates. So, you know, CSR audits is going to be a new area of opening audit opportunity for us. Of course, the objectivity is to investigate the impact of a mandatory CSR spending, optimize the people, process and planet theory, and augment corporate value in turn shareholders value also. So then there is also going to be the requirement of environment, energy, and EUS audit. We know there are a lot of promulgations in place, you know, making corporate, all corporate entity behave very rationally, behave very sensibly. So that certainly is going to open up opportunity in terms of giving more of audit assurance and vigilance assignments you know, like binding on corporates. So that is where our members really need to enhance their expertise. Then we all have heard, you know, the Startup India concept. So, you know, like after this pandemic, we all know several units have collapsed, several existing business, they are really are on ventilators, you know, like saving their units. But at the same time, you know, like with lost employment opportunity, so there are also talents who were earlier underemployment, they are now trying their luck to try their hands in terms of entrepreneurship. So that really will flood in terms of a lot of startup. And that is exactly where, with the virtual medium taking over the world now, so our members really should try to tap this opportunity, you know, in terms of trying to be a virtual startup incubations. We should encourage our clients or the knowns or the contacts, you know, whosoever is willing to make a startup, we should really provide them the whole logistics. We should provide them the whole ecosystems, whether giving a lending address, whether in terms of providing them the handholding supports, right? So we should provide them, the holistic support to create, structure and protect. Then of course the registrations, address leading, to provide support ecosystems, prepare, protect and prosper. Not a king, but be a kingmaker. This is really going to be a golden era where we'll be very happy in 5 years or 10 years down the line to see that yes, X, Y, Z or a person who was a small time employee somewhere, we have helped him and he or she is turning out to be a big entrepreneur in time to come. So let's be very happy, not being king all the time, but also being kingmaker at this opportune moment. Then not last, but not the least, and when you say chartered accountants, you know, like I just shared in my first or second slides, you know, the chartered accountant, of course, has a royal significance, being a term imported from the Royal Charter of Great Britain. Of course, I admit fully that we being a Republic of India, we don't have a system of royal charter. But of course, for all the good reasons, we belong to a royal professions, right? So let the royal profession not be confined just to numbers, accounting, audit and anything. So our members also have a lot of creative pursuits. As I have shared in my third or fourth slides, so there are many chartered accountant brothers of ours who are known not just in India but worldwide because of their other creative talents. So our members should also pursue those talents, unravel the creative writer, critics, appraiser, analyst in us. We are, you know, like chartered accountants having a lot of diversified wisdom within us. We have got a lot of skill sets. So our number game, number crunching is merely a knowledge, right? It's not just the whole skill set we have. So I wish our members should also try their hands and luck in following alternative careers, like, you know, like enhancing their writing skills. We can be critics to various policy. We can also be appraiser. We can write social media blogs. We can be policy critics and we can also be campaigners. So this is on a good note, rather on a positive note. So if our members, with what sorts of practice they have, if they feel that they are not satisfied, or they feel they are not accomplished, or if they feel they have the ability, willingness, and the capacity to deliver more, to prove more, then I have one liner that if you don't like where you are, move on. You are not a tree. Thank you very much. Any questions? Then I'm open to questions. Mr. Bharadwaj, over to you.
Members, bahut acha discussion raha. I expect you to raise questions to our learned speaker.
Anyone has any specific questions, some slides not understood or need me to explain more? Please put forth your questions, comments.
Sir, actually, I feel that bank audit ki लेटर वेटर आने शुरू हो गए तो उसके जोश में जो है वो दे आर बिजी इन दैट डायरेक्शन के भी 2-4 दिन में पैसे आएंगे नया काम शुरू करेंगे
हेलो सुधीर जी
यस
हर्ड फ्रॉम मेनी फ्रेंड्स दैट दे आर रिसीविंग दैट या महाराष्ट्र बैंक ऑफ बड़ौदा के लेटर जो फ्रेश अलॉटमेंट है दे हैव रिसीव्ड इट
ओके वन मेंबर इज ट्राइंग टू रीच आउट टू मी यस प्लीज
प्लीज सर प्लीज
ये आत्मनिर्भर भारत में आप थोड़ा सा आत्मनिर्भर भारत के बारे में बताएं कि हम कैसे क्लाइंट को किस तरफ उसको मोड़ सकते हैं कि
योर नेम प्लीज दिनेश
वरुण
वरुण अग्रवाल
वरुण ओके वरुण अग्रवाल ओके सो यू सेड यू नो लाइक हाउ कैन यू टैप आत्मनिर्भर भारत सर मैं yes. आपको एक अंदरूनी बात बताता हूँ ठीक है There is this protocol that has emerged from various ministry to the nodal PSUs. Like for an example, MOPNG controlling the petroleum companies. Let's say take the example of ONGC, right? So there is this mandate that has emerged from the nodal ministry to the concerned PSU that you should not import or you should not issue any ICB, international competitive bidding, okay? More than 200 crores. Right. So up till 200 crores, you should make indigenous procurement. You should not issue any ICB tender. So that is a written protocol, right? It's available in public domain also. So you said how to tap clients, right? What you can do if you apply your mind and if you really spend some quality time, I don't even ask you to spend weeks or months. One day is good enough to understand. So what were those items which were earlier procured from overseas destinations? Say for an example, ONGC. What was ONGC or GAIL procuring or importing from China in last 2-3 years? You can find it. It's not a difficult task to do, right? So now those are the products which are going to be manufactured in India now because ministry has put a complete ban on import, right? So now you have to find the complementing manufacturer or the competitive manufacturer or the intending investor who wants to set up a manufacturing unit on these products. Really, this is the high time where, you know, like earlier, the manufacturer intending to manufacture used to come to us for a project report, right? Now the ball game is we have to go to, you know, like an investor now, boss, why are you running for a business or why are you feeling like you don't have a business? I am here giving you a business. Here is the business. Here is the demand. Here is the intending buyer. Now you set up a plant.
Yeah.
You got the answer, sir, you are seeking or you want me to elaborate?
Yes, got it.
Girji, I have one question. If I want to work as an arbitrator, kindly briefly explain what is the flow of activities for that.
Okay, so the flow of activities, you know, like of course, I don't ask that you artificially create conflict, you know, within our prospective clients. So of course, in peer group, we know what are the disputes, you know, like the first thing, although I said on the qualification front, we are already qualified to act as an arbitrator. But the first choice I would suggest you that there is this Institute of Arbitrations, you know, like somewhere near Barakamba, you first enroll yourself there, right? So you know, like there is no separate qualifications you require to acquire here. You being CA is qualified enough to get arbitration assignment, but I suggest you first be in their panel. Then of course, you know, like every second or third meeting I am having any clients of mine or even in peer groups or even while be into any campaign mode, I discuss is I have got some issue with vendor or I have got some issue with my customers, right? So the first thing would be whenever we're advising our clients, you know, our clients of course discuss this kind of issues, particularly the recovery issues, right? So we can certainly, you know, like ask them that, yes, we can work as an advisor. The first thing has to be send a letter to the disputing party. So that is how you start the arbitrations. And if you want to make it a formal work, then of course you should advise your clients that whenever they're making any business contract, even in employment contract, you should put at a clause, you know, like that fixing you as the arbitrator. You can do that.
Okay. Sometimes,
believe me. Yes, sir. And believe me, if you advise your client that yes, right, I am your consultant for tax matter XYZ matter. Now in all your contracts, business contracts or business dealings or business understandings, I'll be like, you know, like your virtual arbitrator. You can put my name, you can lend my name in all your contracts. He will be happy to provide you some return receipt. That would be 5,000, 10,000, 50,000. Certainly I cannot assure you, but every client of ours will appreciate. Because we are certainly giving them a legal advantage now.
Okay.
Sometimes this is what exactly I call the value added advice.
Sometimes cases are referred to arbitrator from court. So who are those arbitrators and who appoints them?
Okay. So if you see the arbitration act, sir, you know, like unless if the contract is there, right? So in a contract, you can frame, you can fix who is going to be the arbitrator. But you know, even in the eye of law, you know, one unilateral arbitrator appointment is not valid, right? If both the parties have agreed, if say for an example, a clause in the contract says that you know, like the between the bilateral contract of A and B, A will be authorized to appoint the arbitrator, then B can challenge it, even if your contract specifies that. But if you write a clause like A and B both have agreed to appoint Mr. X or Mr. R.P. Bharadwaj as their arbitrator in case of any future dispute, then you can act as arbitrator. The court cannot interfere there because it is mutually agreed. You have to really word that, you know, like contract very carefully. Because I personally tell you, you know, like in several cases, I have challenged these arbitration clauses that one party will unilaterally appoint the arbitrator. And I have challenged it and I have successfully defended this also. Then the court then after appoint a, you know, like independent arbitrator. Because the arbitration sanctity, you know, like independent sanctity is missing. If the contract empowers one person to fix an arbitrator, because the concept of mutuality is missing.
My friend CA Sunil Snehi is asking, what do you say about CA's role in stock market?
CA's role in stock market. Sir, SEBI and stock market is a gray area. In fact, I am a very poor guy. Please forgive me, even I don't hold a DMAT account.
Can you throw a little light on what the administrator appointed by SEBI?
No, I'm saying, sir, SEBI and you know, like stock market is certainly a gray area, not of my cake. I don't touch base.
Okay.
I'm saying personally, I have stayed away from those subjects. Even as I said, I even don't invest in share market. I don't even have a DMAT account.
Great. अच्छी बात है सर, इट इज अ गुड थिंग.
नहीं पता नहीं, इट आई ऑलवेज फील्स लाइक यू नो,
आई रिक्वेस्ट द मेंबर्स नॉट टू टेक इट अदरवाइज. मोस्ट ऑफ माय फ्रेंड्स हु आर वर्किंग इन स्टॉक मार्केट्स रेगुलरली, दे आर ऑलवेज मेकिंग अप देयर लॉसेस.
पॉसिबल, सी इट्स द यू नो लाइक दे
आर मेकिंग अप देयर लॉसेस.
Sir, if you permit me, I would simply say, no matter, you know, like who is how accomplished, in our own professional area, we still have not achieved 5% of it. So 95% is untapped. So in that, which could be our core competency. So if we have 95% of avenues untapped, why to get into this cheap earning mode of making money in share market? This is my personal opinion. So I perhaps have kept my own inclination and interest in advance, not to invest in share market. I feel like, yes, I should invest in our professional core competency.
Good suggestion.
This is a professional, you know, like personal opinion, but members may take it professionally also without any bias and prejudice.
Any more questions, friends? So Sudhir ji, it appears that all the queries of the answered. I am very thankful to you for sparing valuable time for guiding our members. बहुत अच्छा discussion रहा. It was seminar daily करते हैं किसी न किसी routine topic पे. बट ये लीक से अटके था थोड़ा, बहुत अच्छा लगा, बहुत सारी नई चीजों के बारे में लोगों को पता लगा. एंड आई एक्सपेक्ट के सम ऑफ माय फ्रेंड्स विल ट्राई टू डेविएट इन डिफरेंट डायरेक्शंस आफ्टर हियरिंग दिस लेक्चर. आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर, बहुत अच्छा रहा आपका डिस्कशन. आई एम ऑल्सो थैंकफुल टू ऑल द मेंबर्स पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन दिस इवेंट. Thank you all of you once again. Now I am formally ending the meeting, sir.
Okay. Sudhir ji,
very, very thankful to you, sir, for your sparing your valuable time.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks, member. I really wish all of us flourish. Yes, sir.
There is one more. I want to take your permission to upload this presentation in our YouTube channel maintained by our study circle for the benefit of the members. Sir.
No problem, sir. Please upload, and if it would be great if you can share me the link.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you.
You can, sir.
Thank you, everybody. Okay, sir. Now I'm welcome.